The audience, please rise for the presentation. Brother Goddard, forward. Scott Salute, audience, please address the pledge. Brother Goddard, halt. What's the color? Scott and Salute. Please join me in the pledge of allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Two. Please be seated. Color guards.
How about a round of applause for us? This young man last night got his Eagle Scout award. Kurt Liedtke. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming out for this town hall meeting. I especially want to thank Jamie and Monica with the school here for opening this up for us to have this public meeting on the day before Veterans Day, the day that I guess is officially designated as the federal holiday for Veterans Day, when we remember our veterans. I want to welcome State Senator Dennis Liedtke, State Representative Werner Reschke. Thank you for being here. I want to welcome Commissioner Donnie Boyd, Commissioner Kelly Lynn Morris, and Commissioner Derek McGrew, who are all here as well. I'm going to join my former commissioners, Elliot Schweitzer, as well. So. Figured out driving down its 149th town hall since 2012. I've done around the district. You know, this is a big district. You all know that. I mean, this part of it. Go from the California border, the Idaho border, the Washington border, and the stretch from the Atlantic Ocean to Ohio. Again, you overlay it over the map of the United States. So I feel like the guys that paint the Golden Gate Bridge, by the time you finish painting on one end, people at the other and go, hey, when are you going to come and paint this bridge? But it's a great district, and we have a lot of challenges, a lot of opportunities, and terrific people. And so this is the third visit I've made in Clamath County so far this year, and I think we've had 23 meetings over the last five. What I'd like to do this morning is kick it off and give you an update on what's going on in Washington, and then we'll have plenty of time to engage in a good dialogue and question and answer. Since we are recognizing Veterans Day today and tomorrow, I want to start as we reflect and pay tribute to the men and women who have worn our nation's uniform and defended our freedom at home and around the globe. We've passed landmark Veterans Affairs legislation so far this year, trying to get the issues of accountability and transparency and improvements in the VA around the nation. We have some terrific people serving our veterans in these facilities. We have some terrific facilities. We've also got some problems. Some delays getting people access to care, and we're trying to sort out too. We passed the VA Accountability and Whistleblower Protection Act. We gave our troops the largest pay raise they've had in 8 years. We're providing our military more resources they need to do their jobs to protect our freedom. The House also unanimously passed legislation that I introduced called the VA Medical Scribes Pilot Act. In the private sector, in hospitals and medical settings, they have gone to what they call scribes and sit in with the medical provider to frankly do the paperwork for the data entry so that the medical provider can do his or her job and take care of the patient. Works well, saves money, and gets access to care sooner for those who need it. This passed the legislation. This legislation passed the House, is over in the Senate as we speak, and we're pretty excited about the opportunity to move forward there. I had the chairman of the Veterans Affairs Committee, weeks ago in the road valley, the veterans housing needs and the VA source program there. He's a real advocate for veterans. He is one himself and he's a physician and he chairs the Veterans Affairs Committee. So it was good to get him out here and see what we here that needs help. On casework, we helped more than 7,000 Oregon veterans since I've been in office, including 800 here in Atlanta County over the years, making sure they get the benefits that they earn and deserve. Last Saturday, I know you had a very important demobilization ceremony, and Margie Anderson and Chris Morgan both worked for me. You do want to raise your hand so people know where you're at, Chris, right there, and I don't know where Margie is. But they both are veterans, worked in our office. They were at the demo ceremony in Kingsley. I couldn't be there myself, but I know we celebrated the return of Air Guard members who were deployed to Kuwait, Turkey, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, and various relief missions, including those who were called upon to fight fire this summer. I'll talk about some of the forestry and fire issues later on. Also, having games in, like I try to get to at least once a year, find out what's on tap there, what they need help on. I talked to the Secretary of the Air Force, Heather Wilson. We served together in the House, and I'm trying to get her to come out and see games in the upfront personally. We need to make sure we're on a trajectory to go from the F-15s to the next aircraft, like F-35. Improve their fitness center. It's pretty old and decrepit, and we're going to have these pilots come in and train. We need to make sure they have the facilities they need so we stay on the cutting edge all the way around. Later this morning, I'll unveil a piece of legislation that Doug LaValle, my colleague across the road here, Dumar and I are working on that would address a power infrastructure and water issues affecting the Cloud Reclamation Project, off project water users, as well as the refuges. We'll talk about that at the news conference. I'll put in all the detail here. But suffice it to say, we have some infrastructure issues that need to be dealt with, things like sea flow, and we have affordable electricity issues where we need to work on as well. So we've got a common ground on that and are working on that legislation. Now, let me go to kind of a global look at what's happened in the House. And what's happened in Congress so far. We have passed 407 pieces of legislation so far this year. That's more than at this point under any modern presidency, Obama, Clinton, or both Bushes. During that same time, we funded all 12 appropriation bills to fund the various government agencies. That hasn't been done in 9 years. And last week, we passed really important federal forest reform legislation. So we can actually get work in the woods to clean up forest before they catch fire, and recovery effort after the fire, restore our forest, and put those burned dead trees into a valuable category. I'll talk more about that coming up. In the emergency supplemental legislation to deal with the hurricanes and the floods, Houston, Florida, Puerto Rico, Virgin Islands, I worked closely with the Trump administration and Mick Mulvaney that opened me to get $576 billion in there to replenish the Forest Service accounts that got raided to go pay to fight fire. Well over $2 billion spent fighting fire this year across America. And when that happens, they dive into their other accounts that they should use to do forest resiliency work. They stop that work, and then they use that money to pay for fighting fire. At least we got it restored, but this gets to the underlying issue that they're borrowing from those accounts that are already set up to do work to pay to fight fire. We need to get out of that. Have legislation in this forest resiliency package that's now passed the House that would address that fire borrowing issue so that the project continue in the forest so we can reduce the fuel loads and not have the money taken away to fight fire in the summers. We need both, and we've got legislation going forward. As chair of the Energy and Commerce Committee, my committee has jurisdiction over the Clean Air Act, so I sort of hooked on that to do a big hearing on air quality issues that we all suffer under with the smoke that settles in after these fires. And Dr. John Bailey, Oregon State University School of Forestry, came back and testified. And I said, Dr. Bailey, I realize I'm going to generalize here, but in eastern Oregon, how many trees per acre should there be in these forests? He said, on average, generalizing, probably 20 per I said, how many are there today? He said, about 1,000 trees per acre. You see, Mother Nature continues to grow, and forests continue to grow and die. You know, you've got all kinds of issues associated with climate change, temperature, drought, however you want to describe it, but these are not stagnant forests. And we pay the price for fire. We, Shakespeare Festival Ashley told me they had to cancel 9 performances. It cost them over $400,000 for direct ticket sales. They ended up having to lay off people. Psych Oregon had to cancel the first time in 30 years. The Folk Festival Sisters had to cancel. The schools in various parts of our district, Bedford and Sisters, for sure, had to shut down because it was too smoky to even have class. It's time to act. The House, 5 years in a row now, has passed bipartisan forestry reform legislation. It goes up on the rocks and says, we are trying our best to find a different path this time. And we think we have one. Again, as chairman of this committee, I have jurisdiction over a lot of energy policy. And this forestry stuff gets put in with energy in the Senate. And so now I think we've got a better foot to negotiate with Senator Murkowski and Senator Cantwell over the Senate board members. The bill also has some really specific and important provisions for our district. I would remove the arbitrary 21-inch diameter limitation on harvesting trees in national forests on the east side. This was put in years ago. It makes no biological sense, and it impedes the work that needs to be done. We clarified that the 1937 Oregon California ONC Act prescribes that federal agencies produce at least 500 million board feet required in the law timber harvest. By the way, that funds our schools, that funds our roads, our county. Commissioners can tell you the importance of the ONC funds to our communities. We need to get back to following the law. And so we're working on that. A couple other issues, and then we'll get to questions. We again passed the RAINS Act. This is legislation that came about from a setting much like this in Kentucky, actually. Calling mine, somebody said, why is it that all these major rules can get written that you guys don't have any say in it as our elected representatives? And so the RAINS Act passed the House multiple times, and it says, your elected representatives would get a say in any major regulation that the agency write or it can become law. By the way, a lot of states operate this way. And so that's passed. We are also focused on sue and settle agreements. We found a, I think, really bad public policy past practice of groups that have what they call friendly suits. They sue an agency that wants to get a policy done they can't pass through Congress. So they enter into legislation or litigation. And then they solve that litigation, get the policy they want, and they fund a lot of these groups that bring the challenge to begin with. So we're trying to stop that as well. A couple of things in our committee. We've held 78 hearings, 16 times we've had to mark up legislation. We passed 53 bills out, 85% across the House floor in a bipartisan vote, which is why you haven't heard of much of this stuff, because if we get a lot of votes, scratch out each other's eyes, it's not really news. Last week, we passed the Healthy Kids Act, which was my legislation, to extend for 5 years the Children's Health Insurance Program. That provides health insurance for 80 million kids nationwide and 122,700 Oregon children. We fully extended out 5 years, like the bipartisan bill in the Senate, except we found a way to pay for it. We also extended for 2 years the federally qualified health centers and community health centers. There are 63 of these in our district that provide access to care for 240,000 Oregonians, 25 million people nationally, and a two-year extension to the National Health Service Corps to help graduate education, medical education, and some other programs. And we put off cuts that would have come to our disproportionate share of hospitals. These are the ones that have a higher concentration of low-income people. They're called Medicaid. Hospitals. Oh, you would know that as Oregon Health Sciences University that has a relationship here. That also put off those 2 years of cuts that otherwise would have occurred. We reauthorized the FDA for competition in the drug market and the hearing device market. We took on the big companies that don't want any competition. It said the low to moderate area, we're going to open it up. And I knew I was on the right track because they started attacking me like you can't believe in my dollars. That's always a pretty good indicator to do the right thing. So companies like Bose, that make the headphones, want to make consumer devices for here. They're going to break, open up got a lot of other things. Let me stop with that. But again, it's an honor and privilege to represent the union in Washington. We've got a lot of work we're doing, and I'm just glad to be here in the climate basin again, and I'm happy to take any questions you may have. Thanks. Who's first? And well, we got Nick's got the mic, so you'll work all the way around back and forth. Nick, we got somebody down here.
I'm more concerned that nothing will be done. I'm very concerned, and more concerned that as time goes by, we forget about that. We're not going to forget about this time. What are you going to do about it? And I just looked up this morning before I came, and we accepted almost $3,000 from the NRA. How can you accept money from the NRA?
Well, I'm a strong supporter of the Second Amendment. I take an oath of office with the First Amendment, the Second Amendment, all the amendments. I think they're all important. And when it comes to the situation, there have been several real tragedies, and they continue. There are several things that we've done on this matter. I was one of 77 House members that wrote to the ATF to ask them to reconsider their decision of the Obama administration to make pump stocks readily available. Heretofore, they were not. You can have and own an assault rifle, an automatic weapon, but you have to go through a very rigorous background check certification. Under the Obama administration, they allowed pump stocks basically circumvent that process to be applied to any weapons. So I didn't even think of it. Second, we need to enforce the laws on the books today. If the military had reported the latest shooter as they were required to by law, when he was discharged dishonorably for abuse of the thing, he would not have been eligible to purchase the weapons he purchased. And that is the truth, that is the law. So the first thing they need to do is make sure that the states and the other parts of the government follow existing laws. But at the end of the day, we have a right under the Second Amendment Constitution to have weapons. That's an important right as well. And so background checks matter. The background checks don't work well if you haven't done put the information in the system.
As the nation becomes more and more divided, do you have a plan to?
Did you all hear this? Your man's question. As a nation has become more divided, my plans to help unite us. And I think there are two ways to answer that. First of all, it's okay to have a civil disagreement over policy. You witnessed that here. We have very different views or partial views on some of these issues, and we should, as Americans, be okay debating issues that we feel strongly about, but we should do it civilly and respectfully. When it comes to trying to bring people together. Part of what I was saying in my opening remarks is how I try to address this. When we reauthorize, for example, the Food and Drug Administration, they do all the drug approvals, they protect food safety, they open the market to hearing aid competition. It took months to sit down with people who had all kinds of views in the House, in my committee, and work this out. When it came out of committee, it passed unanimously. It passed unanimously on the House floor. Passed unanimously in the Senate, Donald Trump signed into law. My goal is to see if we can work things out through regular order, through people having access to information, and then sit down as adults and kind of work through it. And when we do, when that bill was on the House floor, I was carrying it, I looked at the microphone and cameras, and I said, only people watching this on C-SPAN are ever going to know we did this. Because it's going to pass unanimously. And that's not going to be a big news story. The next day, in some of the publications that cover healthcare in Washington, they said, oh, by the way, the House passed this bill, and we forgot how to write positive stories about healthcare. And that was the extended story. And so, I hope as a young person coming up through the day, you register to vote, be look at different sources for information, and be engaged, but realize a lot of these things we can come together as a country and work out. Some of them we will just simply have different opinions and we can't cross over, but we should always do these things in a civil and thoughtful way. By the way, the skills you're learning in scouting, I'm a legal scout, will serve you well in this endeavor. So thanks for participating. And you're what rank right now? You're a tenderfoot. So you got a ways to go up the ladder. But the gentleman next to you is an eagle. You stay at that until you're an eagle. Good question. Dave.
Can you tell me what's going on with the ELD mandate? The ELD mandate? Electronic log devices?
Oh, for trucks. Yes. So on the, this is the new requirement out of the Department. I want to say transportation, right, or labor, it's one of the things, transportation. We have a provision, one of the appropriation bills, to delay it a little bit further, because we were hearing from people that this was going to be pretty costly, they weren't ready to get up to speed and all of that. I also hear from the other side, within the industry, that no, we shouldn't. Some of the bigger trucking operations already installed the equipment, say we shouldn't wait. But I'll tell you, we heard from a lot of smaller operators district and said this is a real problem with real work and we need more time and we'd like to have more say so it's not right. Is that kind of where you're at?
Yeah. Same thing. We just want to all be talking about the later time, but still is at the same rate.
Yeah, so that's as I recall, that was a provision contained in the appropriation bill for transportation, and those would be negotiated with the Senate. We passed them all in the House as well, first time in 9 years. And I think that we're literally working out the agreement between the House and the Senate with all of this now. That's something we have to deal with over the next between now and December 8th.
Good morning, Mr. Walden. My name is Josh McCall. I'm a radiology physician assistant at the Skydance Hospital. I'm here today to ask for your support of HR 1904. And Senate Bill 769, currently the CEO.
Yes, so 1904. Can you give me the issue? Because we have about 400 million.
About 400 million, yeah. So there's strict supervision levels that requires the radiologist to be present during certain procedures. And it delays health care. Currently, right now, the patient is getting access. And we're kind of hoping that we can spread this. But CMS and CEO are kind of dragging their feet now with scoring the bill. And I just like to put some pressure on
them. Yeah, let me make a note of that. 1904. And if you'll give Nick information so we can get back to you, I will find out the status on that. Part of what we're working on is trying to expand access. In districts such as ours, I mean, you're far away from our forever. We're kind of in the urban center here, Klamath County, you got Klamath Falls here. So, in one of the veterans bills we passed, for example, allows for telemedicine for veterans so they can actually stay at home. You know, with all these abilities to pull up your iPad, communicate with each other, we do it with family members, we do it with friends. Why can't you do that with your physician? And so, one of those we passed, we opened the door for that telemedicine to expand. And I think there's too many gatekeepers along the way. You're educated well, you know what you're doing. And sometimes it's a pay issue, but other times it's just another roadblock to affordable care. And these are the things we're working on. And that's why these bills we also passed for graduate medical education extension, National Health and Care Service extension, all those are really important in this space, too, Jim. Because, you know, we need more providers as we, some of us age, we're going to be more and more in that healthcare delivery system and access. So I'll take a look at it. Yeah.
the way I can speak pretty loudly. My name is Sherry Swanson. I'm chair of Climate Sustainable Communities. I'm also a local educator. One of the founders of the Climate Tool Library.
Thanks.
Yeah, it's a really cool place. If you guys haven't been there, the Tool Library is a very cool place. I am thrilled that you're listening to fire mitigation. This past fire season was horrific. And that's where my next concern comes from, is the LNG pipeline, the 36-inch pipeline of natural gas is going to be going through some of the most horrendous fire territory that we have in Oregon. And in those places, they call it the Region 1, where they're going to put 18 inches under the ground. And a lot of these, you know, pipes, depending on what you're doing, some of them drive through with construction equipment, or tree fall, or certain things could happen. And there isn't any good monitoring of this pipeline in the planning. To know if there's a leak, because it's not, you know, it's not like eggs, it's not scented. You have to have an infrared drone, right? You have to have an infrared camera, right? So this very real threat of the LNG pipeline scares me there. So I'm wondering what you're doing to prevent this project from going into Oregon. Especially since we have all of the wonderful solar farms that are going on here, we have OIT, and we have a pivotal time where we're able to do some really great changes for us and everybody else.
So let me start by saying, because we do have jurisdiction for that in the Congress Committee. We have probably the toughest pipeline safety laws in the world. There are mandatory inspections required. I can get you the specifics on that off the top of my head. And I think we find that it's a much safer way to move combustible.
That's sending our natural gas to Asia, that's going to raise our gas prices.
Actually, that's not what the data show in terms of higher gas.
That's exactly what they're saying. It's private, it's eminent domain for private gain.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry. It takes all of your land, all of your land.
Look, we have a lot of natural gas pipelines in this country.
Could be.
It
could be. So you don't even know what corporation is going to be putting this through when you're talking about the data.
So I can tell you the data about the underlying issue. There are very strict site requirements, not to use public participation, which obviously is data advantage. We have very strict pipeline safety requirements that we review on a regular basis. LNG has, if you're concerned about reducing carbon emissions, clearly one of the biggest changes that's occurred is the development of natural gas that has replaced coal. And so that is carbon emissions.
Second, it's a pressing issue. This transition, like, granted, we're not going to go off of fossil fuel right now, but solar energy. Like, let's not.
I'm for solar energy.
Right?
I'm for all the above. And all the below. So, yeah, so I actually think it's a much like the Ruby pipeline that came through. I don't know where you were on that one.
Right.
Most that one.
Well, I'm from Colorado, so I've seen the fracking that's happening.
Well, we don't have fracking going on.
I know, but the infrastructure is very similar.
Yeah, so the Ruby pipeline actually created a lot of jobs, generates a lot of revenue that's flowing back into your counties, including here in Klamath County. I don't know. Do you know how much you get off of that every year? How do you know the numbers on that? So the LNG pipe is an educator. You should. I know you got your post, but I get that. I respect that. But this would be $5 million a year in Black County. And 40% of that $5 million would be going to schools like this one.
So where do they get the data from?
That's all public data.
Yeah, but they do the test. They perform all of
and your data comes from? I get a couple of reports and the agencies that do their
corporations that are typing in the
there are independent analyses that are done. So I hope that you're looking at those as well. Okay, good.
$5 million a year isn't worth our resources and our land as Oregonians. This is beautiful land.
So is this, so you're on the pipeline route? Are you on the pipeline route?
We are in the.
You are.
They're all.
But your property.
No, I don't have the property.
Because they have to negotiate with property owners.
And they take care as well.
And I respect that. There's a process for them to go through. And so, look, we also want gas at our gas stations, natural gas at our energy facilities. I mean, and by the way, this export, not only would create a lot of jobs in America and through here on construction and operation, whose county we don't see the best economic place.
So you're not,
also, you're not stop. I'll try not to interrupt you.
Sorry. I just hate it being
like, I hate it. Oh. Well, I'm not lying to you personally. Let me just, when you can give me the data you say you don't have, I'd like to see.
I didn't say that I didn't have the data. I said that I wasn't able to see the exact kind of what type of single study that I've looked at.
I didn't ask you that. I just asked. Is your community building greater than South?
From the corporation, and then Rose Valley, which is a non-profit organization,
that opposes this, right?
Right. Of
yeah, that's fine. We should take all that. I care about our children. I'm a native Oregonian. I am for it.
Thank you, Eric. What about the post-patent bill?
Yeah. So on the tax reform, the House Ways and Means Committee approved it sometime about the time I was getting on a plane to fly out of Washington to Denver here. But we do know kind of in the top line, if you're a family of $440,000 a year in Franklin County, and 74% of you on that threshold. See a tax cut of about $2,000 on average. For itemizers, which is the other 26%, it would still be about $2,000 because we double the standard deduction, there are a bunch of things that get increased, and then we take out all the sort of obvious loopholes that have been put in the code over time. They'll pay for that and make it a much simpler tax code. If you're a family of $400,000, $44% on itemizers, then it would be about $2,300 tax reduction on average. For those that do itemize, it's probably about $1,200. So you still see it's designed to help the class. It's designed to bring the $2.6 trillion in offshore revenues that are trapped there back to America and invest here in creating jobs. The Independent Tax Foundation said they create upwards of 975,000 jobs in America. So I think it's a great way to stimulate the economy and grow jobs and be hardworking Americans play by the rules, not take people good for their money and they decide what to do. Now the Senate's got a little different view of this, and the two are gonna have to reconcile. So you know, I think we need to move forward and we need to figure out as things pop up how we address them. It says several steps along the legislative process. But overall the tax code has become too complicated. Except, I think Mike Betts said it's 10 times the size of the Bible without the good news. It's 70,000 pages. You should have to hire lawyers and accountants and all that to figure out how to do your taxes. We can get it down to a postcard. And the middle class is going to benefit. Because we don't lower the top end to 39.6. Sorry for those in that range. But we really need to drive relief and spur the economy. So that's why this is the job to grow tax factors. I think makes sense. Let me address Medicare, because it is true that if we don't do something to reform Medicare within the next 8 to 12 years, Part A, the hospital part of Medicare, will go insolvent. We sure are. We're working to figure out a way to not letting it go insolvent. And so, Well, there are lots of things we're looking at, like having very wealthy seniors maybe pay a little more. So in the funding for children's health insurance, I was about to answer. So if you're a Medicare recipient, retired, making $31,000 a month, but that's a living, $41,000 a month is individual and on Medicare, we ask you to pay $135 more for your Part B and Part D. That fully funds access for 8 million children to children. So I remember we're really talking. By the way, that's only on the 25% that you pay as part of the premium. And now we're talking Medicare B&B. And these are people making $41,000 a month in retirement. So they would pay a little more. So we're looking at changes like that going forward to help the new premium support like we do on B&B today so that you get a little more competition with government-run plans. That's right. So,
I'm quick interrupting you.
Okay, we're good. Well, there are other people who want to ask questions. Go back to it. But these are the sorts of things we need to look at. Alternatives out there. Now, again, if your company making $875,000 a year, we might ask you to pay a little bit more to help save the Part A from going insolvent.
Okay, so question on the following here. Recently, we got a 13% increase in the we used to, as a company, pay 100% of employees. We can no longer do that. Employees have to pay part of their health service now. We pay right at $1,000 per health service. It's going nuts per month. And the other part of it is the deductible is higher now.
Right.
The coverage is worse. It's the same thing, the opposite.
Yeah, thanks for the question. A couple of things are that we promised that Obamacare would reduce your premiums by $2,500. Instead, I think it was $3,400. So they tried something they thought would work, and it's not when it comes to people like you're describing. And the rates continue to go up and up and up. I met with Senator Mar Alexander this week. Happy Murray out of Washington State are working on a plan that they think would bring premiums down, give more flexibilities to the states to set the how the policy would work. But you have a collapsing individual market, right? And we can't sustain these kind of rate increases going forward. And so we're looking at the energy economy to be all cost drivers in healthcare, one end to the other, from drug makers to distributors to hospitals to doctors. I mean, all across this thing is consumers go, how come that costs so much? Or how do I even know what it does cost? Calling my injured himself a snowboarder. And he actually went around when he got back to Washington to get an MRI and did the work to find out what an MRI would cost him at different places. And the range was extraordinary. How many people here ever do that? Or even know where you can start to figure out what these different procedures cost? So we need more transparency. Process as well. And consumer involvement, we're getting to the point though where people are being priced out. If you don't get one of the subsidies, you're in real trouble. And you see these deductibles of $5,000-$6,000 in premiums that are $24,000-$25,000 a year. I don't know how this ends, except not well. And so it's a continued focus. We tried some ideas, they didn't meet with support in the Senate, but that's not. We're not done. Then in Oregon, we've got a situation where the federal money that you get, they don't spend it according to law. $74 million to spend it. On top of $300 million in the exchange of these laws. And so we've got all the problems here in the state. Okay.
Yeah, my name is Russell. I'm retired. And I'm going to address the 800-pound and I'm going to do it from I'd like to read my text so that my emotion will not become insincere or incitable. There are many of us that think Donald Trump is divisive, dishonest, and in some cases, disgusting and dangerous. You have remained virtually silent of this behavior and rhetoric. Logic states that by virtue of your silence, you condone such behavior and are complicit in such behavior. My question is very simple, and it's not rhetorical. As a Trump Republican, and as our congressman, what is it that your upbringing, your theology, and your ideology that has made it so simple for you to throw compassion, honesty, and common human decency under the bus for the sake of the general citizen?
By the way, I've heard that heartfelt set of comments, almost that same verbiage at virtually every town hall. So thank you for that. And I'm just saying. So, look, I have spoken out and disagree with the press, or I disagree. I do not make any policy to get up every morning and read social media and spend the rest of my day responding to it. I can tell you time and again, there are issues I disagree with the president on. I don't go out, interview the police, punch them in the face, do all that sort of thing. I don't think it makes sense to go tackle people in great groups. And I'm just saying, I can get to this young man's comment early on about how we connect civilly. I work out my differences with the administration. And I don't go, you know, hold the news conference back or anything else. I just march through and try to do my job, because that's really what I need to do. And so, classic example, I was at full, I'll watch my words here, but full disagreement with the Pentagon this week over a provision of the National Defense Authorization Act would have taken all the authority on drugs and devices away from the FDA under their discretion, and they would be able to administer to our troops whenever they decided they wanted to, if they thought there was an emergency. The Pentagon, frankly, has a bad record for that all the time. You need the FDA as a safeguard. And we took this on. And by last night, we won because I convinced them in a thoughtful, logical, non-judgmental way that we have a better policy and a better way to accomplish the goal they had, which was a legitimate one. It's just they went too far. So whatever it is to the pitch about our president or vice president, me, anybody else, I respect that. If you're right to stand up and say what you said. But my job is to get stuff done, and if you look at the output from our committee, that's where my focus is, and that's what I'm doing.
I don't know what the politics are, whether it's a Democratic administration or a Republican. People in the country need to be able to work with the administration, whatever form it is. Here we work a lot on federal water issues. We can't even get a commissioner of recreation in place. Is there anything you see that will speed that process up?
Yeah, it is. It's very frustrating. And frankly, it's so bad, we're going to chase off good people who are going to serve. And I think whether it's Democrat in the White House or Republican in the White House, there are too many of these people that have to go through a really bad process. And we should reevaluate how many thousand people have been set in confirmation the way they treat them. I think the top level people, obviously, cabinet secretaries and all that. But let me just give you a couple of stats. I was reading a piece that Gordon Hatch, former chair of the Judiciary Committee, now chairs finance. Because judges really matter. Lifetime appointments, they're important. Before 2001, only 1% of judges without opposition were confirmed by a time-consuming roll call vote. So they were confirmed pretty easily on a bipartisan basis. Before 2001, there had been 4 filibusters of judicial nominees, and no majority-supported nominees ever were defeated by filibusters. So that was the history of the Senate prior to 2001. At this point, in the Obama administration, there was a whopping 1% of cloture votes on judicial and executive nominees. In other words, Republicans said, I'm going to filibuster these nominees. 1% at this point in the Obama administration. At this point, the Trump administration is 27%. So they are slow walking, they're stopping, they're not letting the people confirm. That really slows down our ability to do our work in the legislative branch. Because when we do hearings, we want to know witnesses from this administration what their views are on legislation and issue. There's nobody there that you can call and have them up to the Hill to testify. So it affects us dramatically. But you know, in 2013, when it comes to judicial appointments, the Democrats in the Senate got rid of the filibuster so they could do judicial appointments without filibuster. Now they're trying to make the argument that the blue slip process. That heretofore has been considered a tool to communicate with the White House, they may have an issue. They are now trying to rewrite history and say that Luke Smith is a single senator veto, and that any judicial nominee that they don't like can't go forward. Heck, it used to require 41 votes, a filibuster. Now they're trying to rewrite history and say what Luke Smith, not the Turner, means that judicial nominee doesn't go forward. That applies right here, right now, in our region. In the Ninth Circuit, we have an opening. A gentleman whose family is from our district, who's been a prosecutor in the U.S. Attorney's Office for more than a decade, highly respected by the House, been put forward by the administration. And our senators have said they won't return the blue slips. There's, as far as we can find in history, never been a requirement for any kind of commission to review the circuit point or court appointment. District. Yes, because that's just in your state. But circuit court is multi-state. If we're going to get people on the bench, we're going to get good people in the administration. The Senate needs to get back to where it's advised consent and not obstruction, delay, and denial. So we can work. The American people spoke on the election. They spoke in this district. 19 to 20 counties, voters here voted for this administration. And so, I'll try it. They spoke, and we are trying to get the work done that the American people said they wanted done when they had this election.
Thank you, Mr.
Walden.
Congressman, my name is Ben Val. I'm a local farmer here in front of the basin. I'll make a couple quick comments. There's a 36-inch and a 42-inch natural gas pipeline right by my house. They're on the way from Canada down to California. And I live pretty close to those. Drive over, probably drove over half a dozen times the other day. And that's the last thing in the world I worry about. They're very safe. They maintain them very regularly. You see helicopters flying over them, check on them. It's the safest way to transport energy around the country. And I just appreciate that, you know, you see that side of it. The big thing I want to tell you today is I want to thank you for the climate legislation that you're bringing out. I'm a young farmer in the project, and the climate projects can be one end or the other. I know you understand that, but energy costs are completely out of sight. And you know, we try working with environmental organizations. I really think that we've done our part. We're very responsible for water that we use. We use by God, it's completely on the air, and they understand that. But, you know, we need some help. And I think this legislation that you're going to have today is a good first step in that. I want to thank you for that. And what do you help?
Well, thank you. I think it's a good first step as well. It's not the only step. We all need to do. If we can begin to address the power issue, we can begin to address the infrastructure issue while we work on the other bigger, longer term issue. And you know, it's we should not forget that history is written by this project gave reference to our veterans. My grandfather itself, Terry Collins,
grandfather.
To come back and settle and develop this land and have an economic future grow food for the world. And we should not lose sight of that, the importance of agriculture in America. And I know we have other issues we need to deal with, and I would argue we are on fish, on forests, all these things we need. and storage. But we need to find a path through here that works and then can pass Congress. Okay, that is the toughest task right now, is finding something with disparate views in Washington that can actually work its way through. So my hope is we might take some of these and fight the time. This would be the first one going forward. And we're working closely with Secretary Zinke and his team on some of these issues going forward as well. So thanks for what you do.
I like the question of what can we do to help you?
Oh, what you can do to help me? Yeah, well, being here this morning means a lot. Thank you. Because I think it's important for you to be here. And I think, too, just your life is hurt. You know, you're coming to the right next to us. You see the surveillance that goes on in these pipelines. They are inspected. They're required to be inspected. And if there's a problem, that way, then let's go fix the problem. But pipeline safety, because I don't want this stuff in trucks, if I can get it in rail cars, and I'd rather have it in pipelines if I have a choice overall. And so, it does create jobs, it does generate revenues, it will help our schools and roads, which can by the way be low, and it can be done responsibly and reasonably. And so, anyway, so your first hand experience is just based on the public process. Do not remain silent. Do not remain silent. Because there are a lot of people that have a different view that are hyper organized and motivated who are speaking out very, and that's their right. They should, but their right to speak out. So, you have a different view in places like this. Yes, yes.
We all see the dysfunction that's happening. Do you think the 17th Amendment principle and the lack of representation at the state has led to some of this?
No, it's a good question. So the 17th Amendment. The Constitution basically called for direct election of senators, by his and that was passed because there was so much corruption at the state level, basically selling the Senate seat. Because prior to direct election, it was the state legislatures that they're the ones who picked the senator. The brilliance of that original process was you link the United States Senate to the state, because they had implemented the federal government. That is a former state senator and state representative. I always wanted to applaud my federal people too, because they kept sending us mandates and money. And so I don't think we'll ever go back to the days when the legislature picked senators, but I do think making sure that we make sure our senators are accountable to us on a regular basis is a good thing. And make sure they're back, and, you know, are here. So, and I think our senators do come back on a regular basis. So they are out of the district, and that's for the state. That's important. But the dysfunction has gotten beyond that to where tools that were there and sell the food now to the weaponized, the loose on judicial appointments, where it used to say, hey, I want to talk with you about this, I have concerns. They're trying to rewrite history to say that's a single senator veto. Filibuster, remember, Mr. Smith goes to Washington, isn't that the one where the guy who's standing on the Senate floor filibuster forever? They don't do that anymore. Make him go down there, come on, filibuster, have him spend all night down there talking if they want. They get away without having to do that. And so we really need to focus on what Americans want most, that is to solve problems in this country and come together despite our parts of difference.
As a retired Kansas school teacher, I'd like to thank you for your support on issues like secure middle school funding and the Healthy Kids Act. My question is, can you talk a little bit about the move towards vouchers and where your position on that?
Yeah. You know, first of all, thank you. It's good to see you again. Good to see you come to Washington. On education, we all want the best for our kids, whatever that is, right? We have different views on how to get there. So We have alternative mechanisms now, charter schools and things like that. I've always worried about vouchers in a rural district that you can very easily pull out financial resources for public schools if you go down that path. Because we don't have, you know, enormous populations. And it doesn't take much to pull the legs out of public schools. I want really good public schools. So do you, and that's why you bought it. Our son's brought it to public schools, my wife and I both are. And I think for our community's sake and for the melting pot of country, good solid public schools are very, very important. You have a chance, if you want to go some other direction, at religious schools, you have a chance to do charter schools. But I've not been a big advocate of that.
Thank you, Mr. Walden.
Thank you.
Mr. Merrill.
Thank you.
Is civic duty. It would be a lot easier to do that with less more than 4 hours notice. I'm not sure where, but really, Congressional District 2 in Oregon has literally formed a resolving rapid response team. But my question, as a self employed individual who is trying to hang on to John and Alex. I wonder what is your objection to considering at least a public option and at best single payer healthcare?
Yeah, thank you for that. We try to get those out. Sometimes we don't know what my schedule is going to be. We were totally positive that we were going to have folks that would be me and not be able to get out. I think it's in the paper Wednesday. So we can try our best. And it's on our website. And I got the district about every weekend, and very good at the so, you know. As far as government runs the fair system, that's one of the options I know we've talked about. It would mean that you have one government system making the choices. That means it wouldn't be a Medicare or Medicaid or VA, it would be all one entity. And I'll tell you, we have that in the VA, in the government system. I have two people who work almost full time, and half of all of our casework in the office is trying to help veterans get access to that health care in that system. And I'm not one who believes the government has all the answers and can do it the best. I actually believe that where there's competition, you can get innovation and choice and hold down price. One of the problems in our health delivery system with a bunch of competition. Now, Medicare is a wonderful program. My parents are both on it, my wife's parents are both on it. I was there when we wrote the Medicare Part D program to deal with the high cost of prescription drugs for seniors. We had choices to make there. And at the end of the day, the cost of Medicare Part D is more than 40% less than what they estimated it would be. Premiums are still on average in the $35 a month range. Senior approval is about 85 to 90%, and we drove competition in that market. It is an exchange that works. You can have an exchange that works. By the way, right? And so when we talk about how do you reform Medicare so it's solid for the next generation, these are the sorts of discussions we should have. Because we just keep doing the status quo. We know the outcome. CBO says in 2025, another firm says 2029, the Medicare Part D goes insolvent. At that point, they then pay a percentage of what's left in the fund for health care. That would be 88%. Now, if you have trouble finding a position that will take you when you turn 65, 66 today, wait until you reduce that payment. And so these government-run plans I have concerns with private plans as well. I'm not saying they're perfect. They need it. And that's why, you know, the lifetime cap is a bad idea. People with pre-existing conditions not being able to get on the plans, bad idea. And so somewhere in this, we've got to find a way through on Medicare. But I'm not a fan of the similar type of system, just because I think the cost would be extraordinary according to those who analyzed it. And I see it every day in the casework. We've been trying to help people get the care they've already been promised, and they are our nation's uniform. We can't take care of them. So, I worry about it. Nick?
Well,
we'll be back.
And, you know, I'm talking about that
stuff. Yeah.
It's very frustrating to be trapped in this water crisis and this endangered species crisis stuff, because I don't think it's fair that, especially regarding reclamation projects, that they were designed and built and backed by the American public long before the PSA was passed. And now the PSA is passed, and they've just been able to sign, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We're charged with the full cost of recovery. I think that all Americans should be charged with the full cost of recovery if the action was to modify the habitat, was undertaken in goodwill,
by the
government,
and by the government. We did. So I share some of that feeling in the sense that with the government. Former colleague Bill Graham actually said that dead end starts coming into regulation and new laws. It's not that those laws are necessarily bad, but they have a societal cost. And I think we have to be very careful that that cost not be borne by just a small segment if it's for the benefit of all society. And that's why we should have partnerships with the private landowners, in this case, to achieve a goal we probably agree to achieve. But you shouldn't have to bear all the costs. It's like we're dealing with the salmon recovery and Colombian snake system. A lot of the pressure is being put on the couple of river systems that have no hands is if they have a full solution to this. And so they're trying to do some really big changes on cap grazing and all that, stubble height, and things that don't make sense at the level they're going. And so I think it's really important to take a step back and say, we're coming with collaborative partnerships here. So we continue to have vibrant agriculture and English runs and all that. And some of that we've done is pre-engaged now. I think it was a good partnership. Some of the equipment money that came in, some others where we can do that. But at the end of the day, these laws taken to their extreme don't save the species. They just go on this, and they put us to others who lose their jobs, who lose their farming, forestry. Yes, sir.
I'm Joe Bingfield. Now, to answer this question, we're being charged right now by five counties to take these dams out. So, whether we follow the insurance, whether we return on that investment, I don't know how much investment we're being charged with to come out. So,
yeah, it's actually broader than that because I'm a Pacific Water ratepayer of it. And so we're getting our bill as well, as you know, in holding licensing effort. Public utility commissions play a big role. And so they're the ones who weigh in a little bit in terms of, they look at it from a consumer ratepayer position. So what's it going to cost to relicense versus remove? When they did that, their analysis showed for ratepayers, it would be less expensive to remove than to license. Do all the changes. ESA changes involved in those other licenses. So that's where then we, the ratepayers, bear the cost. Along with there's other state and federal money that would come in. Well, wait a minute, who is the state and federal money? That's us too, it's just a different pocket, right? And so that's all working its way through the system. But at the end of the day, whether they stay or go, we're not going to, either for the ratepayer cost to do the fish passage and other restoration work, or if they don't move the cost. And it's the way it works. Yeah.
Removal of the dams entailed an effective section 10 habitat conservation. That was the major restoration action that would allow a lot of the refugees and farms.
we're talking about some of your cost issues we'll talk about later today, this legislation on infrastructure and power costs. So I would say we have time for one more or two more questions. I think this is later.
You know, in the district that you're having housing
yes.
problems and different things like that. If these programs are gutted, housing issues are going to fall to the state. And this is a very rich district. What are you going to do about this?
Yes, we already have. The budget was presented this spring. The appropriations committee, the House and Senate have already marked up the spending levels of those programs. I can get you the specifics against the city housing programs. Happy to get you those. In most cases, they have not followed the administration's budget. And I would just tell you, we are separate branches of government. And in most cases, no matter who's in the White House, Capitol Hill, you go, thanks for your budget. I'm going to do it tomorrow. Now, eventually, you got to work out, Mr. President, that's the sign of it, right? But in the case of our FDA reauthorization, they wanted a whole different funding scheme that we wanted in Congress. And they sent me a letter the night before we were going to vote on this bill in committee. They said, oh, we don't like these things. And I said, thank you. And we went ahead and moved our package forward. And guess what? The President signed it. You see that a lot of these programs, his budget, I think, was too skinny, they call it the skinny budget, and you're seeing Congress now say, okay, I don't work for the president, I work for the people I represent, so what I would suggest is if we can follow up, we will get you the info on it. This housing is a huge problem. We see it in addiction recovery, we see it with our veterans. I've been in several projects over in Medford recently and talked to people involved in Hamilton, and affordable housing is not only for just people working every day, people are coming out in the transitional housing. They finally go through a treatment program for opioids addiction or something. And then it's like, thanks, glad you got through the program. There's the door. And they fall back out into the streets because they have no income. And guess what? They go right back into the cycle. There are programs, both the public-private partnership programs that work really, really well. In Oregon, they don't require much of a federal investment in enormous rate of return, where they now part of these homes and work your way into a job, and it's very affordable. So the success rate of keeping people falling back into their addiction is off the chart. So we have some really good models of work, and Oxford House, it's the Oxford House Education Organization, really effective. So good. Give us a question. We'll get you on some.
My question on the tax reform bill.
Yes.
You're going to eliminate the estate tax.
At the end, yes. That's what's going on.
Okay. How are you going to treat the tax basis? Is it going to be updated like it is now? Or is it going to be
step up basis or not? I don't know the answer. I'll get back to you. I don't know what they did in the end. I don't know either on that piece. I know it's an important piece of it, but if you send us your info, I'll get back to you on that. I know we continue to increase the exemption to like $10 million, which takes care of a lot of farms and ranches and small business, and then it ratchets up, and then in the end, the retirement will go away. There's a debate about whether you need to, whether it's the right policy to legally the estate tax to get down to. Not very many people, frankly. My preference is, I'm not a fan of the estate tax, never have been. I think you work all your life, you can spend your money, you can save your money, you can invest your money. We all want our kids to have a better life than we've had. And that's always one of the motivating things. It gets really, I'll say, expensive when you're doing other tax reform to completely eliminate it. And I think even people in those, hundreds of billions of dollars in asset territory would say that's all right. But we could take care of virtually every American with a $20-50 million exemption. It's really staggering. It's really interesting. Now, there's a level where you take care of those small businesses, ranches, and farms. And I grew up in Cherry Orchard with Dow's, been around a lot of ranches and farms and orchards over my life. And, you know, you got your land rich and cash poor, you know. And the tax man comes on the door of the funeral and says, hey, I want the cash. And then you're having to sell things off, you're having to do all this stuff, and that's not what we should be about. And so for my focus, I'll get as much as I can so we don't disrupt. And you know, then you allow farms and ranches and small businesses to continue to reinvest and grow and be sustainable for the next generation, which is what we should be about. All right, well, thank you all for coming out today. I really appreciate